Happy New Year. Oh, like Deborah, it sounds like something out of a fairy tale 2017. It's like an Elvin Toffler book I read somewhere. I can't remember exactly what the details are, but it's hard to believe that it's moving forward. I'm really pumped about this year. We're going to do the Living a Value-Based Life. And, you know, for the next 52 weeks, what we're going to do is we're going to talk about it. So I thought that what I would do, because I've got a very short period, because Deborah's only giving me this much time today, which I'm blessed with, but what I thought that I would do is I would ask the question of why do we want to live a value-based life? What is the upside of living a value-based life? And I know that a lot of us probably already think that to a large degree we do, and probably some of you do, live an extremely value-based life. But the key behind it is this, is that the inherent person who you are, the truth of your being, that which resides within you, in perfection, is something that grows, attracts, and moves through the universe by its own natural selection. What prevents it or stops it from occurring in our life is when we step out of line with our values. Every time I've ever done something that was against my values, my personal values, which happen to be very synchronistic with the values that we teach in this teaching, surprise, surprise, every time that I step out of it, what happens is something occurs which seems to bring conflict into my experience or into my life. Perhaps I'm not the only one who's discovered this. That inner voice that keeps telling you, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that, and then I turn around and do it anyway, and the end result is I find that the experience is something that I'd rather not have. And what happens to a lot of people is that once done, we continue to do it, and we wonder why the same circumstance keeps showing up in our life over and over and over and over again. And it's because what we're doing is we're going against the core belief that we have, that which we hold to be sacred, that which we hold to have value, and we're not expressing our own value into the world. We're not living to it. So the first thing that we need to do is we need to be able to define what our values are. Not our values according to some religious doctrine, not our values according to what our mom and dad taught us, not even our values according to what society taught us, but our values according to what we hold to be true. This is one of the things what sparked me when Dr. Deborah was talking about Reverend Jeanette's diversity workshop. What really sparked me about it was until I went to that diversity workshop or went to a diversity workshop, I didn't realize how the values that I hold to be true were being muddied and muddled by society around me and therefore giving me justifications and things that I was doing which were outside of what I held to be true on the very core of my being. And therefore, what I was doing was I was putting a separation between me and the divine authenticity of who I am. And by doing that, what I'm doing is attracting into my experience a whole mess of stuff which I would rather not experience, and then wondering why the heck that was happening, what was going on with that. This is the kind of thing that I hope and I trust that we will look at, and we will take an in-depth look at individually this whole year as to what our values are and how we hold them to be true and how we can express them and live in alignment and congruence with what we hold to be true and what we hold to be right. Dr. Holmes said that the desire you have to be something, to do something, is a mental echo in your mind, in your mind of the spirit which already exists within you. It is an impact of your divine and spiritual self upon your mental or psychological self. It is the spirit in you seeking an avenue of expression through you. It is the real self you would like to be, the deep spiritual self, having all knowledge, having access to all power, being one with life. This is the self that heals the sick and raises the dead. It is a transcendent, triumphant self. It also is the self that attracts into your life joy and love, vitality and energy, creativity and divine expression. This is what I trust we'll be working on this year. And he also says, in demonstrating over the conditions, the only inquiries we need to make are, do the things that we want lend themselves to a constructive program? Do they express a more abundant life, rob no one, create no delusion, and express a greater degree of livingness? And if we're able to answer these questions affirmatively, then all the power in the universe is back of our program. All the power of the universe is back of who you are when you live to the authentic self and you live to your own values. This is going to be an exciting year. I'll turn it over to Deborah. And what we'll do is we'll step in and do some intentions and some releases and set this up. Yeah. And there's no chairs out here, so I'm going to go sit down.
Okay.
Have a good time.
Okay,
and I'll listen.
Your mic's still on. So I think no matter how many times we might have been through this kind of annual change of the calendar, and no matter what might have happened in the 12 months before, I think there's always that still sort of an unfailing sense of hope and expectation of the promise of the new year. And how I look at that, that is that spirit in us that Dr. Holmes, through Kenn, talked about. That impulse to want to have our very best self to be expressed. And for sure, the new year, as we mark it on our calendars, is a great time to do that, because it's very clear that that one's finished and we're moving into this one. And so we're going to take this particular New Year's Day to reflect on our achievements and maybe some lessons that we might have got from the past. And we're going to set some intentions, not harsh by the line resolutions, but gentle and loving intentions for ourselves for the upcoming year. And I think that even though people usually do have the best intentions when it comes to setting intentions, because we're all about awareness and clarity here, I wanted to first start by sharing three things that can sometimes potentially sabotage our highest desires. So even though we think we're so clear and we know where we're going, we know how we're going to get there, sometimes things take us sideways. And so I just wanted to bring into our realm of knowingness these three things. And the first potentially sabotaging thought is knowing that, or thinking that, when we set our intentions, that we must rely on our own personal raw willpower to change our thinking and being. If that's the way we enter into it, without trusting that there perhaps is something greater supporting us in the process, it might become very difficult to hold that willpower in place long enough to really give the process of change the opportunity to show up. So that's the first caveat. The second is, if we set what we want in our lives only looking at the outward results of what we're going to get, instead of looking at our beingness as the source of what we want, we might be disappointed as well. And the third caveat is, if we find ourselves feeling frustrated or guilty when it seems like what we've chosen, what our intentions were, aren't coming about or aren't coming about fast enough, this often leads to sort of a path of self-denigration or discouragement. And those emotional atmospheres really only help to keep our desires further at bay. So we want to watch out for those three things. Studies show that to move successfully from one set of experiences or one year or whatever that is to new ones, it's important to look consciously at what happened previously and to let go of any negative emotions we might have associated with them, and then to be grateful for the positive things that happened and the lessons that we learned. And for sure, the more we find gratitude in the events or for our past year, the more we're going to find to be grateful for in what is coming to us as well. So those are just a kind of little crib notes to keep in mind. And so we are going to use today to reflect and to celebrate and to keep working what's working, and to take 15 minutes maybe to wipe the slate clean of what is not so much working for us. And then we're going to focus on our desires and what we want to accomplish in the five major areas of life. And so it might be something new, it might be new goals, it might be new ways of looking at things, it might just be the desire to have greater awareness or love or compassion. And we're going to do this through what has become somewhat of a ritual here through the years, and we kind of changed it up a little bit because we don't want anyone to think that they know what's going to particularly happen each year. And so we're going to have each of us walk out the doors this morning with some powerful written reflections and intentions. And I want to actually acknowledge Pam Thompson for some of these. She used to be here. She's since moved to the coast, but she gave me some of the ideas behind this. So in your program, you will find on your insert, on the flip page, is the questions that we're going to be looking at this morning. Everybody got one? Anybody need one is maybe a better question. Okay, if we could maybe get a greeter to give, I think we're missing a couple in that back corner here. I hope our greeters are Johnny on the spot about that. I should have asked ahead of time. Did anybody go? I don't know. Oh, yeah. Oh, awesome. Fred's on it. So you're going to find, maybe eight questions on there. And I'm going to lead you actually through them. We're going to start with a little bit of a brief centering quasi-meditation. And then you need a pen as well. So you need that. And we do have a few extra pens. Jeanette, you can just give them the whole program. They could put there's one here that needs one. Oh, I guess that wasn't well executed. We should have had Kenn go or talk, and I would have arranged this. Trust me, you don't want me to sing. And Barb needs one over here too. Thanks, Jeanette. All right. Is that it? We're all good? One more in the front and a couple more back there. All right. We'll test your meditation skills. So while they're doing that, I'll invite the rest of us to just allow your eyes to close. And allow this present moment awareness to move you into being maybe more with you and your thoughts than you might have been through this busy season. So just allow yourself to go to that quiet, still place within, that realm of mind and heart. Just create within yourself a place of peace and love. And in that place, find that living, active, light presence of the divine and perfect wisdom that is always within you. So just allow, go with, and let yourself be inspired and led by this light wisdom within. Letting go for a moment of any preconceived thoughts of your own personal or human limitations. And trust this higher mind to be known and fully revealed through you with ease. Let yourself go into what's calling to be known through you. And so let your mind's eye scan through your year of 2016. Go back to the beginning, back to last January. Think of where you were at that time, what you were doing, who was around you. Then move up through the first quarter of the year, then through the spring, move through the summer, d- just reflecting and remembering. Move into the fall. And then through the past 3 months of 2016. And now we're going to go to the questions on the insert to help you focus more directly, but I'm going to walk you through it. And just give that loving reminder to be brief and yet clear. And know that writing these things down physically is an important part of this process. So I'll be reading each of these and offering a few stem ideas and give you a little bit of time now to write what comes. And then you can complete this more at depth in your own time. And so on that insert, the first question under reflections for 2016 is, what are the achievements I am most proud of that happened in 2016? What worked well? And why? So what did I really love that happened this year? Just a few words, you have a small space. Just a few words that will remind you if you want to come back later. But what am I most proud of that happened in this past year? What do I really appreciate? Remembering is so powerful. And that leads us into the next, and maybe something different. So what am I most grateful for this year? Just find one, two, or three things that would be at the very top of your gratitude list. What are you so thankful for that happened or was around you or you noticed? What am I most grateful for this year? And you can be grateful for the good and the not so good. Remembering that you can come back to this at your leisure later. But what are the lessons learned about relationships, about work, about your own blind spots? So what did I learn this year? What do I want to keep in my memory? So what might need improving and why? But it's important to remember this is not about blame or chastising yourself, but this is to truly get the value and the clarity of what might not be serving you anymore. And remember that awareness is always curative. There is a value in remembering, what isn't serving me? What do I need to move away from and just be clear about? This one's really important, so I'll leave us here for a little bit. Again, I encourage you to come back to this later. But now we're going to move out of the past, and we're going to move into our very best future. And so this is under Intentions 2017. And you'll notice the first question is, what are my intentions for 2016? So the most important step, please forgive me for the typo. And again, so I just want to give a little bit of heads up. It's really important to remember to write your intentions in the present tense as if you have already accomplished them. Present tense, and from your I am. And so the first intention for 2017 is under the category of health. So this will be what your personal best picture of your personal health, what it looks like and feels like. I'll give you a few ideas. Might be things like, my body is toned and strong and flexible. I radiate vitality, health, and wholeness. My health is great, physically, emotionally, socially, and spiritually, if you choose. But what does your health look like? Your intention for your best health for 2017? And again, just a few words to remind yourself of what these are. The next is wealth. So this is what your abundance, your prosperity, and your financial life looks and feels like from the perfection of your intention. So this might be things like, this year I earn an average of X dollars a month. Might be things like, I feel financially free and serene. Might be, I am completely debt-free. What does your abundance and financial life look like from this viewpoint of how good it could be, of the perfection of it? And so we move into the realm of relationships. This is what your relationships look and feel like. The perfect relationships. Might be things like, I surround myself with supportive, healthy-minded people. I enjoy meaningful relationships. Or it might be your relationship with yourself. Something like, I acknowledge and accept myself with love. What's your best intention for your relationship this upcoming year? The next category is creative expression. And so this might be your career, your vocation. How do you spend your gifts, your talents, and your time? Could be a broad spectrum of what spirit's expression looks like through you. This might be things like, I am connected to myself, my gifts, and my strengths. I express my creativity, my God-given creativity, easily and effortlessly. Might be releasing old ideas or limited beliefs about your sense of fulfillment. And last, but certainly not least, is what are your intentions for your spirituality this year? It's what your spiritual life, your inner life, looks and feels like. It might be a choice to meditate or treat daily. It might be really consciously investing in your spiritual community. Serving your highest and best self with your service that moves through you. What is your intention for your spirituality in 2017? And so knowing that you can come back to this for sure at the end, let's just give thanks for everything that has been revealed to us and through us. And gratitude for actually taking the time to contemplate these ideas and to make note of these very important aspects of ourself and our future self. And so we give thanks. So it is. Thanks, Waleed. So I'm trusting that everybody got something. And again, this is just a kickstart to it. I encourage you to work further. You can change the questions if something came up that is more relevant. By all means, put that in. And so then I encourage you to take the paper, put it in your purse, put it in your wallet, and I give you a challenge to try to remember to pull it out quarterly and to remind yourself of these things ongoingly and to keep them in your mind's eye as things move forward. And when you start to see results, because I know you're gonna, I want you to celebrate the accomplishments, even the incremental movement forward in ways that are important and special for you, because as you empower them, you're going to feel better about them. They are going to manifest more strongly and more greatly. And so I just want to wish everybody the happiest of New Year's and bless you all as we move forward into our values of happiness, fulfillment, and inner peace in 2017 and beyond. So peace and blessings, and thank you for being here.